We have Patras Buanzi here, and he will be reading in English. So this is an English event today. If you need any translation, just ask your neighbors and we'll probably manage. So our Wednesday evening event is every Wednesday, but we have different events. Today we'll be reading, next Wednesday will be a movie that we will show, and we will prepare some food. So if you want to know what is going to be the event of the Wednesday, just look at our website or call us in the office hours. Our number is also on our website. Yes, this is the office of Oliver Hilfinghoff and me from the House of Representatives in Berlin. If you have any questions about our work, just contact us or just ask me after the reading. So today we'll be reading with Patras Buanzi, and afterwards a discussion with Patras, with me, and with Berenice Bülow, and hopefully also with you. And we will try to picture the current situation of the refugee movement in and out of Berlin, with the focus of the people that were protesting at the Oranienplatz in the last years, but also go into the current situation of especially Syrian, but also refugees from other countries coming to Berlin and coming to Germany and Europe. The reading will be with Patras Buanzi. I will say a few words about Patras and then we will start. Patras came from Uganda. He was a Ugandan activist from school times early on, and he also is a textile artist. He also began early working on textiles and other materials to try out his art history. He was fleeing the country because of the repression and because of political persecution, and he was coming to Germany in 2010. He came to Germany in Berlin, so he was experiencing the situation at the Lageso 5 years ago. He was there, and he also put this situation and put his experiences there in one of the chapters of his book from which he will be reading. He was sent to Bavaria, and he was in a camp in Passau, and he was supposed to be there and stay there and not get any refugee status, but he wasn't. He didn't stay in Passau, but he was joining with other refugees, and he was continuing his political campaign as a refugee and as an activist. With those other refugees, he went from Bavaria to Berlin in the famous refugee march, and then he was one of the refugees that was protesting on the Oranienplatz, then also on the Pariser Platz, then again on the Oranienplatz, until the so-called compromise that the Senate did with the refugees from the Oranienplatz last year. He will also tell us a little bit about this when he is reading from his book. This year he was, first of all, he's still active. He's giving workshops. Some of those I will announce at the end. Workshops of different kinds. And he's also active in writing and publishing. This year alone he did two pieces. First of all, he wrote a little manifesto that is called We Are Born Free, Humanity Matters. This manifesto is to be read and downloaded online, and you can download it for free. The second piece that he did is a book, which is called My Name is Bino Bianzi Biakuleka, and that is a book that he wrote together with Lydia Siemke, a German author who is not present today, but they did it together as a kind of collaborative piece, parting the chapters. So she's writing some chapters and he's writing some chapters, and together it's a book about his activism, about his situation as a refugee in Berlin and in Germany and some other experiences. So, and from this book he's reading today. So thank you, Patras, for being here, and thank you for reading from your book. My name is Bino Bianci Biakuleka.
I have my mother-in-law, she's here, but she's a German speaker. I don't know if we'll get someone to translate for her, but maybe mainly in the discussions for the reading, not necessarily not discussions. Yeah, thank you very much, Fabio, and your colleagues, and yeah, nice to meet you again, Berenice. It's a long time. And all of you, some of you, I know you, some you know me, some I don't know you, but we are here today to know each other and yeah, to discuss not only the issues I wrote down, but also the current issues which I wasn't able to note down, or the issues which took place before me. So, yeah, if my reading is not correct, if it doesn't sound well, you will pardon me, because I was not born in the UK, where the English come from, or United States, but I was born in Africa. So, sorry, but I have to use the language which was forced on me in order to communicate to you. Therefore, without taking long, because I have quite a lot and I would like at least to read half of it. I'll begin with my first chapter, which I called Protest, or My Protest in Uganda, or My Life Experience in Uganda, My Activism in Uganda. It's before the moment the cane hits your butt. Somehow they always position you in a way your eyes are filled with the sun, but you know they are all there. You can hear them. It is embarrassing. Everyone looking on during school parade, some with pity, sure, but quite a few planning to add their own funny ideas later to this punishment. This is my experience in the school, during the school, my earlier age. You just ask yourself, why are the teachers doing that? The fact that I will not stop me is obvious, so clear. My actions will become more determined, no doubt about it. Why do they not see that? And when the heat comes and it really hurts, a small moment of weakness falls. The pained body briefly appeals to my will. Please make it stop. It is not good. But then strength returns and I can expect the second hit with ease. The third one is meant with a tight, ever more determined boom that almost makes the cane break. I say, tetwazaliwa na luzungu, mutuleke fe. We are not born with English. Leave us alone and promptly get another extra hit. That was my experience during my childhood when we were forced to learn to speak English at school from the lower classes. I had been caught speaking my mother language or my mother tongue again, Luganda, instead of English. I was demanded in school. And that always seemed a good reason for should we continue? Okay. I had been caught speaking my mother tongue again, Luganda or Lusoga, instead of English. I was demanded in school, and that always seemed a good reason for my teachers to beat us. Sometimes the teachers asked students to beat each other when these could not speak English. So many just kept quiet until school was over. I hated English because it was forced on us. Every day, a student was elected to be English master among the students. He had a chain with a pig jaw or bone on it, and he had to put it on the first person he heard speaking their vernacular language, or our native language, Luganda or Lusoga or other language. It was shameful to carry this bone, and so whoever had it wanted to get rid of it quickly and tried quickly to catch another person speaking their native language. Each one who found someone they passed the bone on to and had to write down the name of that person on list. Sometimes they used a large coin left from the colonial rule on a thread instead of the pig jaw. In school, I became politically active and popular as a result, only with the students. Of course, I wanted to become assistant head boy, but the teachers were against me. No wonder, as I criticized them for the way they treated us. A lot of beating without any reason, sexual abuse on young girls, expulsion of students motivated just by antipathy. I wanted to make the students aware of our school rights or students' rights. I planned to report our problems to the school authorities as well as the Uganda National Students Association. It's called the UNSA in short. That was in 1997. I was very reactive on that. In addition, I used to draw cartoons of the teachers and publish them in the school weekly newspaper called iFocus. In our school, we had a paper called iFocus. We formed it in our club. So, the beatings during school parade happened surely not only because of my bad English, but because of my political activism or engagement. Finally, out of school and at university, I studied art and design. We call it DAD, the course in short, at Buganda Royal Institute of Business and Technical Education in Mengo, Kampala. It's now today a university. It's called Mutesa I Royal University. During my course, I was totally convinced and confident with hopes, and I believed in the work of my hands, in the art, the crafts I was learning, and I saw my future clearly ahead. But it had been a long, hard way to get this point through school. During this two-year course, the diploma course, I had six subjects. One is history of art, drawing, that is nature and still life, weaving, fabric decoration. There we learn about motifs, patterns, applique, where you compile another object to attach another cloth to another and form a cloth. But this is just an example of applique, what we call applique in fabric decoration. Mosaics, mainly I learned about mosaic paper through paperwork, but the other is like glasses and so. Painting, where I majored in portraits on the landscape. Market management. Therefore, in my first year, that was in my first year. In the second year, I dropped fabric decoration because I wanted to focus more on painting and weaving. That's where I learned this. It is one of my fabric weaving I learned from Uganda, but it's not only this. In this way, I came closer to realize my future dream of becoming a professional iconographer and industrial textile designer. And that's how I managed to get the scholarship to go to Greece to study iconography. My second chapter, it's about the German surprises. And that's how I became a refugee. I became a refugee on July 29th, 2010. In the early morning hours, I arrived in Berlin by plane in order to ask for asylum in Germany. I had traveled with a friend, and for some reason, no one asked for our passports at the airport. It was all a new experience for me, as I had never been a refugee before. The Office for Refugees in Thomasstrasse, the central office for all asylum seekers in Berlin, was closed, and I waited as the day was getting warmer. I enjoyed the sun. I don't know if it's really true. I was convinced that they will accept me and that I will stay in Berlin. I had no idea what would happen. As no one had explained to me how this will work, asylum. I thought they would say, "Hell, nice to meet you. How can we support you or help you?" As the nice word they like here. How can we help you? But no one said so. Nice to meet you. At home in my country in Uganda, we used to welcome new people. We give them time and treat them as guests. With time, you get to know a person and find out what they need. I thought they would give me a room and then speak to me a few days later or a few hours later. What do you want? These are the questions they fired me. How can we help you? What qualifications do you have? I had all those papers ready, and because I was planning to continue with my studies in art after having a secure status. But no secure status until today. I had not expected that they would take my fingerprints before anything else. It was a very strange greeting. The doors opened around 1:30 p.m. I went in, and with the fingerprints, they asked me a few questions immediately. My name's, where I come from, and why I was here. I didn't know what to talk. I didn't want to talk much. I was so tired. I showed them my big bag and said, "All of me, I'm here." I had to fill in a form and then wait for further questions. After 1 hour, they gave me 25 questions, and I thought finally that that was all I had to do. That now they would grant me asylum, but oh no, it was on contrary. It was only my introduction to German bureaucracy. Those people in Thomasstrasse, they looked very tired of welcoming people, tired of those people altogether who stood in front of them full of hope. Their eyes and bodies said so. "Look, black people, why do you keep coming here? We have so many other people we have to take care of. Go somewhere else." They were clearly making a distinction between the people who were listed on their lists, on their papers, illegal, and me, as a Ugandan. There were many other people they called in before me, and none of those were black. This hierarchy of refugees also was a strange surprise to me. Finally, they said I had no chance to seek asylum in Berlin, and instead they would help me to go to Bavaria. Exactly at 8 p.m., I was in the train from Berlin Hauptbahnhof ready for my journey to Munich. The train was different to the ones in Uganda, which is the leftovers from the colonial times back then. The trains carried, used to carry gold, cotton, and rubber. Now that they were, that they are nearly dead, they carry people. These are the trains today we changed, we use as our transport network. The railway lines had only been extended to distant places because of the goods and for the trade connection to Congo, not for people at all. I could not sleep because I was so excited. This train felt good because I was not alone, but at the same time, no one disturbed me, touched me, or harassed me. Only the police control. And when we reached Munich, we all parted. Everyone went on his or her own way. No one said, this way we go, this way. No, I had to follow my own way. But everyone went on his way or her own way. We had been on this train together, and as outside, I felt tired, loneliness, but I had to find my own way. That's German, or this German, or Europa. Okay. My third chapter. I will jump. I will not narrate everything, because I want to go on something so that you pick something. It's about my father and me. I learned that my father was murdered when I was very little. People shed tears narrating how he worked as an accountant in the local coffee and cotton cooperatives trade union, which called Busoga Jinja, and that others were jealous because he was young, clever, creative, and successful. Apparently, some people planned the murder and bought others to carry it out. My uncle told me that, in fact, I had been with my father at that time when he was murdered. I was 2 years old. The killers had not expected me there, and so I was told, just threw me over the fence to the neighbors. By the way, the neighbors, like, I think around this time, or they had me crying in their compound, and they came over looking, and they found me outside. After the murder, people who knew my father became very angry and organized a search for the killers all over the region. They destroyed the houses of those who were suspected and chased them far away from the region. But the killers were never brought to justice. Times back then had been hard and confused. It was the time of when Idi Amin had just been overthrown. So the country was really totally in chaos. The killers took the advantage of the political chaos and civil wars following the fall of Idi Amin Dada. People were living in fear, especially those who had money. Money was also the reason why my father had to die. Envy and evil eye on others is a disease in our society of this day. After I found out the truth from my uncle and others, I decided to change my names and took those of my father. That's Biansi. Mainly my father gave me a different name, but when I learned, I had all this news, I said I am Biansi. I want my real father name, because people always, they used it, oh, you are like your father, Reed, you know. So I say, oh, great, so I have to take it. Bino is a recent name because of my political activism, which I took when I started the protest here. Altogether, it means leaving behind the things of this world. Bino means things like anything you can use. Biansi means this planet, the planet, or the world. Together means, for instance, here I translated it in a simple way, the teapot from this planet. And Biakuleka means leaving, something you leave behind if you have to go. If I am a guest, now I am here as a guest, I will not take this chair because it is not mine, it is not given. So this is my interpretation of my name. My name's that if we die, so we have to leave everything. So why then we have to say you are illegal, you are so and so. At the moment, as a person with refugee status in Germany, I feel reminded of the circumstances of my father's death and the family situation it created. There are people in this world who do not know, who do not let others live, who protect what they have with an evil eye and refuse to share. Being reduced to an animal in the lager with no plan and very little freedom or hope is a slow form of murder. The memory and the spirit of my father made me say no to the lagers and let me put up my first tent in Passau Kloster Garden. My next chapter is about my recent protest in Passau. I said no to the caretaker, the housemaster. No thanks. No more Essene Pakete. Because by then, in 2012, in Bavaria, we were receiving Essen packets as food. No Essen packages for me. I will not eat anything until I get out of here for good. So, all of the sudden, I got out, and that's how it happened that we started the protest in Passau. How could this happen? For us, it was always so obvious that in Europe, and most especially in Germany, everyone has the right, the same right. Everyone can participate in the democracy freely. There they have freedom, but who? So, why am I sitting in this tiny room with the six people and I cannot go where I want to go? So, suddenly, the whole absurdity was over for me, and it was clear in my eyes, and so I decided I do not have to sit here and wait. I will just leave. Therefore, also no more lager for me and no more resident fricked. This I told the passerby at Klostergarden, or the people in Passau. There we made our protest public and erected our tents. A lot of people were unfriendly. Well, it is Bavaria, you know it. But in the end, we had more than 1,000 signatures the people supported, only within 3 months. And there I painted my first poster, which I still have. That is how the protest started for me. This was my first banner I painted. It's time for revolution. Enough is enough. So that's what gave me the power. That was our first banner. You can put it over here. The first night sleeping in the tent was so amazing for me. I was over the moon that I had succeeded. I did not worry about what was going to happen the next day. I was proud that I had left the lager. Indeed, it was. I was really proud that I left the lager, and until today. It was a white tent. Many good friends visited. Lots of people came past. They asked what we are doing there. Some said we should go away, some not. I was ready to fight and to die if necessary. The Nazis, for example, always said they would attack us in the night. They are also governed by different circumstances, diseases. Sometimes my friends left me alone in the tent when it was too cold for them. Already in Passau, I don't know that year what happened. From September it was really cold, 2012. And my friends, they said, no, we can't stay here. We go back to the lager. I say, okay, go. But for me, already I declared, I swore that I will never go back to the lager in whatever case. I'd rather go there when I'm dead, but alive to go back to the lager, no. So that's how it happened, that sometimes I had to sleep alone in the tent. The camp started on 8th of August, but it was already cold. September was so cold that year. I don't know. Maybe the Nazis did something. And October even more. The weather was really unfair for to us. But it also just so, as I said, no to the weather, I will go further. It is time to take my rights. I knew that I would not get my rights just by sleeping in that in a tent, but this was about public awareness, to let the people feel how life is in the lagers, because they had no idea about our situation. Often, I slept outside under the stars. There were some benches in the cluster garden. They were really well constructed. I could take my sleeping bag and hide in the bench. Sometimes I was not sleeping exactly in the tent. I could go in the bench on the other side and sleep and watch the tent, because there were, of course, the fear of attack. We thought they will attack us anytime, so we could watch just from a distance. The bench they had underground, and it, you can see the tent. I could take, it was comfortable, and I could watch the tent from this. The protest, it was my pride and motivation. I was convinced that all I was doing was right, and indeed it was right. I felt it inside, but also from all the support I got in person. So there were other protests in Regensburg, Augsburg, Munich, Cologne, Aup, and other areas. I traveled around and met many of my fellow protesters. It gave me even more strength to be with them. Suddenly, it was not a demonstration, but the police were accompanying us somewhere on our march to Berlin. It was near Magdeburg. No border, no nation, stop deportation. It broke from my mouth, my voice of protest. Protest had always been at my life, but for the first time, I really heard my voice in the public. It is through the tent. Now the protest was not only for me, but my voice had decided that I want to change the system as a whole for everybody. I often miss my family, yes, but somehow I feel at home. another point. Being a refugee without a status in German, what's our everyday experience? First, it is important to distinguish being a refugee as activist. The everyday life of refugees in Germany, in Europe, is stress. Nothing else. Stress, trauma, from all the constant threats of deportation. Not only that, on top of that, no right to work, no right to move. All this uncertainty about being able to stay or even destroys a lot of people. Some people wait 2 years, they are there in Delaga until today, for even their first interview. There is nothing good for us in Lagos or here. We eat and sleep and go to toilet and wait your day to go to be deported. That's all. They do not want us to die, but they certainly do not want us even to live. Many have paid a lot to come here. They have sold everything at home to pay the visa and all the rest along the way. People come with high expectations to be able to earn, to change their life. And when that is impossible, people, they decide to kill each other, to commit suicide, as you have been hearing, as it was also one of the most extreme point why we decided to march from Wolfsburg. It is one of our friend from Afghanistan who committed suicide because of the threat of deportation. He said, no, where you want to deport me, I can't go back to Afghanistan. The work value and time that goes into this paperwork exceeds 10 euros. And for me, it was a nightmare to save, to find the money. So why? Nothing is gained it other than making life difficult. You have to eat less or to steal money or to lie, only to have a little bit of freedom. Document examples of the immense bureaucratic effort necessary to leave the lager. I have some papers here which we had. For instance, these are my personal experience that about resident freight, that we had to pay 10 euros. That was what I was trying to explain here. If you want to move, if you want to visit a friend, if you want to go to another city, you have to ask a permission. And that permission must have also the invitation. You can't get it without invitation letter. If I want to get to come to Berlin, I have to find who is in Berlin, who knows me. So you have to write a letter with full information. How am I gonna survive? How many days? For what reason? For, you know, and when am I going back? So you can see some of. But remember, we are not working, but where by then to get the 10 oils to pay that. So I said, no, I cannot live this life anymore. Inside the lagers, people talk about their backgrounds, their expectations. They try to give each other strength, but my friend, it's not possible. It's only for me. It's the only solution was to join the protest and to support each other and bring out our voices. If you look at Cluster Garden, how big it is, you will say you are crazy to occupy this. But I knew we have to be crazy to change the system. Capitalism and imperialism, you have to face it directly. That is why our great men are assassinated, like Patrice Lumumba, Thomas Sankara, John Galanga, and others. For refugees or refugee activists, everyday life is stress too. As I described before, and the great challenge is to keep going despite all the setbacks. Activists must not focus on their own personal issues, but give their time and strength to the protest. Most people cannot earn money. Some are lucky to be in local support initiatives, for example, crafting furniture, kukula, which it has been misused, abused. There is a lot of support in kind of food, clothes, as you witnessed here and also in Paso during the protest. Every time we are receiving clothes, and also we thought that the Teoplat city was also becoming a dumping place, not a protest anymore, but a dumping for the garbages, all people who were tired of that stuff in their houses, they had to bring at Teoplat. Phones, tickets they brought, which need to be shared well. Often there is too much people. People are generous, but this humanitarian aid or help is not so important. Solidarity is what is needed. The people who want to support refugees need to make the next step. Meeting us, respecting us, listening and sharing their time and expertise, that is priceless for us. Not in the name of helping. So the last one, I think, because of time, I will end up with, I think, one. We see. But it's about colonialism, and the picture our people they have about Europe, as Europe having golden streets and so. So, is it true? I do not know if I should say this, but why not? It is partly my reason for being here. It is why I stood outside at Tomostra's office and I thought my asylum application would only take a few days. I assumed they would treat me according to my human rights and dignity. I do not speak about this phenomenon much. Somehow it has become a secret of the past, and I feel it is literal crazy, but here it is. Now, many people in Africa trust the Europeans more than they trust themselves, than they trust other Africans, because of what colonialism did. They built people they think, or they believe, that through colonialism we have hospitals, or the colonialists built schools. The first, like in my country, the first school in my town was also built by missionaries, which were brought by colonialists. They say the first person to make an airplane was a white man or woman. The first person on the moon as well was a white. They feel they could not do this. And as a child, we looked at a caterpillar, I don't know if you know it, or a pyramid. You know a pyramid? I mean, not a pyramid, a millipede. There's a black, brown animal with millions and millions of small legs. Yeah. So we used to look at it, and we say that the white man made the train, used the same knowledge to make the train from the example of this small animal. So we were wondering how wise the white man there, you know, by looking at a millipede. So you can see how from childhood we are spoiled. That is how wise we never expected that we can. We never believed that we had the technology to do that, or to do these wonderful things. To this day, many Africans believe that the white people are organizing them. When the 20-year war started in the north of my country, in Uganda, in the 80s, the people asked why they are not helping us, the US, the Europeans. But the USA only came in 2011 saying that they want to help Uganda. In fact, they only came because we had found the oil, and because they wanted to have a military base with a view to Congo and Sudan, and as well as Somalia. And still, people clapped their hands when the US troops arrived in Uganda. It was only the president who said, no, we have to help ourselves in the end. But in the end, he had to accept their help in order to strengthen the U.S.-Uganda relationship and to prevent further bloodshed. Although he did not like the intervention, even now he is encouraging the African peoples to develop their countries independently through the East African integration, apart from the Western forces. But he is also leaving his shoes to rot because he has become a dictator since 1986. He captured power through a guerrilla war. Until today, is the president of Uganda. So it's nothing. I would be happy if he would call me to take off the office. No need for guns or PhD. I would use my art to institute real democracy in Uganda. Before colonialism, my country was well organized because we had clan leaders, chiefdoms. The colonial forces destroyed the structure by planting literal misunderstanding here and there. In the end, they even supplied guns. The first guns here in Uganda at Kampala on the Seven Hills were fired by the European Britain perpetrator Frederick Rogard. No. The king's loyal to the colonialists became greater than others. The whites helped them to get land that they did not own, have ownership before. In the 1900 Buganda Agreement, land from this region was sold to the British government, and then Uganda became a British protectorate. The British also helped the central king of the region of Buganda to get to acquire land off the from the Ankole region. And finally, at the end, the king of Ankole, he was sent to exile. In the north, similar things happened. In the governor from the British protectorate to my region, Busoga, in order to correct taxes, they used, I will read, with it, he was to establish administrative offices and political structures on behalf of the British government. They sold the land of my region, which used to belong to the people as a whole. The British chose a clan in the center of Uganda all over the others to work for them. They used them as instruments to colonize other regions. They used what we call indirect rule. In my country, I think it is Uganda among the African countries where indirect rule was applied, because they were not going to succeed, because my country was organized, so they had to find a way how to colonize it. And I think that's how Germany failed, even though it had the interest in it. That's why today we have Uganda Strasse here. Some of you don't know. We have Uganda Strasse invading at Afrikaner Strasse because the only point that German by the time of Kaiser Wilhelm had the interest in Uganda in East Africa, and he sent Carl Peters to go and collect the signatures from the kings in Uganda, and they had already accepted, but they didn't know. But according to the Berlin Conference and the charter they did, they found out that it was in the spheres, in the premises, in the perimeters of UK, Britain. So that's how German it happened, that it didn't manage to colonize Uganda. But to glorify Kaiser and Carl Peters, they named Uganda Strasse. And this problem, this fight was sorted out in London. So if you want more information about that, you can read about German colony in East Africa. The people in the center, they said, are wiser. Look how colonialism then. The people in the center, they said, they are wiser. And this created a breach in the his society as a whole of Uganda. Only in the center, because only in the center, the colonialists built good schools, big colleges, and hospitals like Namirembe and Mulago Hospital. One is called Albert Cook Hospital. And they named these hospitals their names. And in the center at Mengo district was the home or was the parish of the king. All new good things were there. The rest of the country got nothing. Apart from one bridge that connects the center to the east, but this was not built for the good of people, only for the colonial goods, like the trains. They often said proudly that they built this bridge for us, but not. However, we were paying this bridge until 2005. Uganda was paying the debits, you know. We had to pay for everything that was built. But they always acted as if they were giving presents. They also bragged about abolishing slave trade. But they used the forced labor to build the things we had to pay for. It killed many and very badly paid. Still, people were and happy, but about the hospitals. In schools, we only learned about the positive side of colonialism, the hospitals and the termination of diseases, the schools and the Western education. But nothing about the cheating, forced labor, the violent treatments, and the oppression of native language and culture. this we don't learn about in our schools. The downsides of colonialism are not taught. In fact, they do not teach African history at all, but mostly European successful stories. So, is it okay I end here, or? Yeah? I think it's enough. Are you satisfied or not?
Okay, thank you back again. We will continue with our discussion. First of all, I would like to point out that this book that Patras was reading from, my name is Bino Bianzi Biakuleka.
Biakuleka, yes.
Is already available, so you can download it on the internet. You can go to microtext.de. And download it there. You can also pay for it. It costs €1.99, and you can download it for your Kindle. So it's a little commercial right now. And we are also collecting some financial support for Patras for being here. You can put it into the box, and it will go directly to him afterwards.
Not only for being here, but also for my activism, and also to pay my lawyers. I'm still paying a lot, the lawyers, about the police oppression and also resident fleet and so. Yeah.
So you're suffering consequences from going from Bavaria, from the lager, to Berlin.
Not only going, but to protest.
Yes.
These are also the documents. I wanted you to see quick. It's the Ausweisung. Say after 3 months I started the protest, they said no, this man is dangerous, must leave German immediately. And this is the following one. And I have recently again another one. You can just have a look and you will understand your country.
Yeah. So I actually wanted to talk to you first about your political activism in Africa, in Uganda.
Mm.
And so I wanted to ask, your father was murdered. You wrote this in the book and you told us about it. You were politically active and you went to Europe when you got the chance to escape and to leave the country. And to come here to Berlin, and still you're most probably not getting a refugee status on the grounds of the German Constitution. I think that's the situation right now. What do you make of this? What do you make that only a little percentage of the people that ask for a refugee status in Germany will actually be considered political refugees?
I don't want to concentrate on that and about political refugees or getting political asylum, because for me it's another term of dividing people.
Mm.
It is a tactic of capitalism. But what I would like to say that all people, they get their right to stay, because this, what we are demanding is our fundamental rights, and every human being is entitled to be where he or she want to be.
Mm.
Not only because of war, not all people that we have to play that the wars must come in our country so that I go to Europe or to Germany.
Mm.
We want to share our lives, to have new lives, to have new experiences, you know. And these movements have been there since the world was in existence. That's how Europeans happened to be. Before, there were no Europe, you know, if you look into the history of the world. So it is because of this free will movement, free. That's why Europe, it came into existence. That's why we have USA. But originally it was not there. On this planet, it was the human being existed only in Africa. That's the findings of from 5 million years ago. It is only 200,000 years ago that human beings started moving northwards, upwards. That's how Europe it happened and USA. But otherwise, for me, it is just clear that there's still ignorance, there's still lack of understanding of human being, and that's why I am saying that humanity matters, and that we as now people who are trying to bring out these issues, we should concentrate on humanity and demand fundamental rights for everyone, not demanding just political depending on the situations. No.
So you're against judging people by the reasons or the official reasons why they left their country and went to another country?
Because I don't think that Syrians are happy to be here, or they're happy that the war happened in their country. Even if you ask them, I don't think so. I've been meeting them, I have friends, they have been sleeping in my room, but they are not happy that the war happened in their country. They never wanted to move. So how can you now, you, German, as a superpower, or a well-organized, or a democratic, or where we see that there is a source of democracy, and you, based on this catastrophe in the homes of these people, and said these are the right people. It is just because of colonialism. It is clear that we are living in the world of colonialism. Yeah.
I would like on this matter to bring Berenice Bülow in and to say a few words about her. Berenice is a lawyer with the focus on
migration
and migration affairs. You're also on the board of the Republican Lawyers Association, and you were also involved in the process of the Oranienplatz agreement, or in the Oranienplatz negotiations last year and the year before. You were very close to the group and you were advising them on certain matters. Last year also you were involved in the negotiations of the Gerhard Hauptmann Schule in Kreuzberg, and you were also trying to solve the conflict over there. Talking about the judgment of the reasons why people leave their country, and about the situation of acceptance of people as refugees in Germany right now, is it any realistic that there will be changes? Right now we have a new backlash on splitting up the good refugees, the bad refugees, the good reasons to leave their countries, the bad reasons to leave their country. Is there any changement for the better? Is this going to change, or is this even going to get worse?
Yeah, thank you very much for the invitation, and thank you also for hearing your reading, because I did not know that you write this, so I will have a look. It's really interesting. Yes, I mean, there's so much to say on it. Like we were just speaking before, the very strange thing I think we saw with Oranienplatz is that somehow it was very important for the city, it was very important for the society to get to get aware of the situation of refugees, yeah, all the question about Residenzpflicht and Lager, all this really became a subject because of the protest, and finally also resulted in changes by the law, which were not sufficient and which were made in bad circumstances, but anyway, somehow the protest in a way was recognized, and also a lot of politicians declared themselves solidary with the movement and said, yes, we understand there's a problem. So one of the consequences we see right now is that the people who really made this fight got nothing from it, really nothing. And this is very strange on one side. On the other side, I think, and this will be the answer to your question, this all is part of the logic, or maybe the not logic, or the converse logic we see at the moment, where we can see that the newest law, which will come into force on 1st of November, is really a backlash, and is really trying, like we saw this long dossier one has to have in order to ask to quit it to another town of Germany, like to write 5 pages, you have to have this within the file. And all this system, which everybody knows, failed totally. They are now reintroducing it in a much more brutal way than ever before. So I really feel that something happened in this society, which goes back for long years, and which was the movement was a kind of catalysator, so that this maybe came more quick or more deeper, that parts of the society understood there is a big problem, and this problem about this society here. It's nothing which is like hunger in the world and children dying because of hunger. Everybody of us knows it. Everybody would like to change it, but somehow it is like this. We learn about it in school, but yes, you would like to change it, but it's like this. And all this movement with refugees and the refugees coming here, I feel that a lot of people had this feeling, okay, they are here because it has to do something with us. It's about our society, actually. And I feel until now that a lot of people are willing to see this and to understand this and are starting to think about. And somehow the politics try to make a step back. So that's how I see the actual situation.
You think that the some political parties are trying to take back changes that have already happened because the society has evolved a little bit?
I don't know exactly, but I think yes, this is part of it.
I want to talk to you about the political activism of refugees in Berlin and in Germany. You described the situation that you faced in the Lager in Passau, knowing you will be denied a refugee status, you will be deported, and you have very little contact to the outside world. Nobody will know of your fate. And you decided to do something about it. We just had this statement a few weeks ago by the responsible secretary, Thomas de Maizière, who complained publicly about refugees that don't just want to sit in the lagers and that want to go outside or want to go to another place or want to leave the country and are not just sitting there standing still. You see a lot of shaming of refugees that are here and they are fed and they are given money, but they want to be active, they want to be seen, they want to be changed their own fate. How what do you make of this? How should people behave, and what should they do about their own fate here?
There's no question as to stand and demand their rights and dignities. That's why we are here. No, if it wasn't so that in my country I was not free, why I would have bothered to come to Germany? No. So to sit in the lager and think everything is okay because there's free food, because there's free money, it's not what we want here. That's not why we are here. We are here for the change. We want things to change. Whether it is political or economical or social, we want things to change. I myself, I want things to change. That's why I'm keeping on my struggle, even though I have been facing repressions, not only from the state, but also other agencies of the state, like police and so on, you know. I believe that everyone, most we, the so-called refugees, must take the power in our hands. Because if not so, then our struggle is meaningless, you know. So, really there are very many examples to reflect on. There are very many realities to reflect on to give us enough evidence that there is no need for us to wait in the lager or to sit in the lager. And the statement from this minister is, I will not consider it because it is nothing. And it's the same from his both, Angela Michael's also, all the same bullshit. Because from what, according to the recent situation you had, Angela Michael saying, oh yeah, we have to open the borders, blah blah, and but in reality the borders were not open. Germany didn't open borders. No. It was a statement to say, hey, hello the world, we are still the power, we are still having our glory. So that's what Angela Michael did, wanted to take the advantage of the current situation of the refugees to say, hey, Germany is still on the map, you know. But all these stupid people inside, they are still looking to see that there is no hope for refugees here in Germany. Of course, and if we are to explain more about the reality, what happened in the last 2 years since we started our struggle, since we started to occupy the public spaces, where these ministers,
do you think they never appeared? That it's the primary goal of the authorities, yes, to silence the struggle of refugees?
Exactly. Yeah. Where have been Angela Michael? She never appeared. It wasn't simple. Our protest, it was a big thing in Germany, but she never appeared. No, but recently, because what is our protest about is changing. A demand for a change of the asylum laws from this an inhuman situation to a human situation. And this is not in the interest of the German politicians. That's why they ignored us. But the new refugees coming, this massive refugees of movement, it is the interest of Germany to show, oh, we are here. And really, it happened. Indeed, they saved the image, because 2 days back, after Germans went on the train station, urbanists welcomed the refugees. Mm. And one of the local news in my country, they wrote, oh, finally, with the refugee crisis in Europe, German with a big heart opened the doors for refugees, welcomed the refugees, you know? But what about these bureaucratic, brutal bureaucratic laws, steam killing refugees in lagers, in trauma, in stress, and they are not discussed.
About there are some politicians in Germany that are actually discussing it, demanding more repression, demanding worse situations in the lagers, less money that is given to survive, because they say that it's necessary to make a worse image of Germany for asylum seekers, so that there's less people coming.
Yeah, that's you know. And are you surprised?
Not totally.
You know, your country is one of the unique country in Europe. You know how it is, its system built. It's built on racism. And racism, it's within the system. So these people, they are not alone. They are not talking alone, but they are talking as a system.
Do you see any changes for the better?
Of course, as the with the new movement of refugees and the power we still have and the power you give, there are changes.
Mm. Yeah. I don't know, Patras, do you want to say a little bit about the situation of the Oranienplatz refugees and what is their situation right now?
I think, as she said, the politicians themselves, they didn't know what they were saying, and they didn't know what to say exactly or what to do. But on the other side also, I believe that they knew what they wanted to do. They didn't know what to say, but they knew what to do. They wanted to do. What they wanted to do is to make Oplatz weg, to get rid of the refugee struggle in Berlin over. That was their plan. To call these dialogues negotiations, it was just a way to show the public that, you know, we are friendly, we are, but it was not in the interest of the refugees. If it was in the interest of us, they would have come out with a clear solution, a good solution, not a brutal solution. So for me, it came clearly in my mind that that was the idea, to clear the camp, but they didn't want to be physically there. They wanted to see if they could use the refugees to clear themselves. So as I mentioned earlier, that it was still we are in the colonialism era, that they used the mentality of the colonialists, as their colonialists, to divide the people, and that's all. So they came in as people looking for something to give, But in other words, they wanted to see where's the weak point, where's the weak way where we can go through. So they found out that most of the people, if you talk about sleeping places, they will accept immediately, or giving them money, free money, they will accept immediately without explaining it. They will just say yes. If you talk about giving them papers without explaining it, because the woman, she's talking about colored, she was promising them duludung.
Yeah.
That I will give a duludung. But for us, it was clear. We know what duludung means. Means you are tolerated because we have no your papers, you have no capacity to deport you.
Mm.
We have no clear address where to deport you. So for us, who were already in the scene in the protest, we knew that the protest is over when our friends accepted it.
Mm.
And that is it. When they accepted this offers without a guarantee on these offers, you saw that very early on the 8th of April 2014, people, they decided to demolish their camp, you know, with some tip-ups, talking something. They were given on that eve some money. Insiders told us that each and every one, they were taken to a room and they promised 100 each, and they are even given hammers, things to destroy the tents.
Mm.
And it was,
yes, it's I think it's pretty well documented that they were promised money and given materials to,
yes,
destroy the tents.
They were given. Even what happened afterwards, some of those leaders who led the operation to demolish the camp, they didn't want to give the money to others, and then they had a fight afterwards.
But even if that was the end of the struggle at that time, do you think it can be revived? Do you think it can come back into existence?
That effort will never come back, from my experience. But it doesn't mean that the struggle is over. You see, we are moving, not only here but everywhere. The other people, they are fighting for borders, you know, open borders. Others, they are stopping deportation. Other groups are working on different issues. You know, we are writing, we are, you know, there's this campaign which came out immediately, My Right Is Your Right, it is still going on, you know. And there are so many struggles going on, and I think we are moving.
Mm.
And you see every refugees aware. We are no longer in the doom, and but people, even if we are not in the same situation where in the same struggle where, but everyone is active.
You're better connected than a few years before.
Yes.
Okay.
I think there's a change and people feel empowered. So the destruction of our plots never changed anything on us.
Mm.
We got more power. Yeah.